at 7 o'clock, so we'll, and we have a quorum, so we'll go ahead and get started because we've got obviously a few folks to get through tonight, so I want to be mindful of everyone's time. If I could just remind committee members here to speak into the microphone, I'll remind John when he gets here as well. It makes Bernadette's life a lot easier once we actually get going. So if Cam is all set, all right, great. I'll call to order the Thursday, January 12, 2023, North Andover Community Preservation Committee meeting. Pursuant to Chapter 107 of the Acts of 2022, this meeting will be conducted by in-person and via remote means. Specific information in the general guidelines for remote participation by members of the public and or parties with the right and or requirement to attend this meeting can be found on the town's website at www.northandoverma.gov. For this meeting, members of the public who wish to watch the meeting may do so on their televisions by tuning to Comcast Channel 8, Verizon Channel 26, or online at www.northandovercam.org. Every effort will be made to ensure the public can adequately access the proceedings in real time via technological means. In the event that we are unable to do so, despite best efforts, we will post on the town website an audio or video recording, transcript, or other comprehensive record of the proceedings as soon as possible after the meeting. If the public would like to participate in the public meeting, please email your questions or comments prior to or during the meeting to CPC emails at northandoverma.gov. The question or comment will be provided to the committee before the meeting or read during the proceedings if received during or shortly before the meeting. Thanks, John. Sorry. Before we get started, I'd like to just take one quick moment and recognize our staff member, Gene Enright, who is the 2022 North Andover Town Employee of the Year. You've done a tremendous amount of work for us and for numerous boards, so we want to thank you for you. Okay. Next, before we get started with public comment, I just want to address a couple of things right up front. There seems to be a lot of stuff floating around discussing regarding the purpose of tonight's meeting. Just for absolute clarity, there is we're not taking a vote tonight on anything other than approve our minutes from the last meeting. The purpose of tonight's meeting is to meet with potential applicants as a part of the notice of intent process, help guide their applications for the upcoming application deadline, which is February 3rd. So just want to be very, very clear about that as we head into it, because I think there's been some confusion out there in public domain. So we do have some public comment, which is in the record, some emails that we have received. Do I need to read every single one of them? Or? Okay. All right. So I'll let those stand in the meeting packet to be accessed. If there's anyone present in the room who wishes to offer public comment, I'll open that up now. Just go ahead and come to the microphone, state your name and address, if you would. Okay. Seeing none. All right. Next on our agenda, we have the CPC financials. I gave them a quick look. Everything seems to be in order. Does anyone have any questions or comments regarding our financials at the current moment? We did notice we got a hefty state match, I think in excess of $600,000 this year. So I think we're looking at a current free balance somewhere in $5.4 million or so in that range after encumbrances. So great. Next up, Project 1394, the Old North Pump Station boat launch, giving us an update on this project that we recommended in town meeting approved last year. So, Gene or someone? Great, excellent.
Hi, Bob Rafferty, Environmental Partners. We're the engineering consultant doing the design on the boat launch concept at this point. I did bring a board, or if it's going to be up there, we can kind of walk through it.
Well, it depends on what's on your board.
It's just one of the drawings.
Okay, great.
That one, right there. There you go. All right, so we're bringing this to you today. We've already been in front of the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board, and we're working with the town committee on the concept here, and we've gotten a lot of excellent feedback. As you can see, there's a number of edits, you know, scratched on this plan here. I take it just a general overview, but to clarify one thing, and there's a cover letter in the submittal package, and I don't think it really states firmly enough that we're not creating a boat ramp here, all right? There's no intent to allow boats, motorized boats, or trailers to access the water. There happens to be an old dilapidated boat ramp there, and it was only for the town's use, not for the public's use. So we're just going to use that location specifically because it's just very convenient to put a boat launch, and that's only for hand carry boats, canoes, kayaks, and car top carriers. So the general plan is to move the boat racks that are there now closer to the boat launch area to make it easier for people to access the water. And we originally had a circular turnaround there, and the Conservation Commission suggested that we make a small driveway leading towards the water so car top boats could get easier access to the water. I guess there's more permit holders than there are boat racks, so people car top in. So we added that. So, all of the driveway and all the parking are going to be permeable pavers, as well as the boat launch and so forth. So we want to, you know, get the water to fall back into the ground. Right now it's all hard pan out there. It really just doesn't soak in at all. We're going to do some work along the shoreline to make it more of a curved structure there. We're looking at some living wall technologies. What we don't want to do is armor this so that it looks like, you know, some battlement of some sort. We're trying to get it so that it looks more natural. So we're looking at block construction or living wall types things. The boat launch itself, we're going to put some impediments in there to stop anybody from getting an idea that they can bring their motorboat in there or back their trailer up to the water. So we've got a curb step. We don't know at this point if it's going to go up or it's going to go down. We just got our survey in, so we're going to start that part of the design. The driveway is narrow enough that you're not really going to be able to put a large boat or a car down there, and there's a choke point right at the top of the boat launch itself, so you can't back down. And we're working on the slope of the launch at this point to make it easier to get a hand-carry boat in there, but make it flat enough that if you tried and you got over the curb and you got off over the inset boulders and all the other things we're putting in the way, if you backed your car down in there, your car would be in the water before you get your boat off the trailer. All right, so we're doing everything we can to do that. At this point, we're ready to launch the 75% design effort, and that's the end of this current contract under the funding that we have right now. That's going to get us ready to get the permitting done, which is a substantial effort, and it's going to take months to get that through because of all the work on the lake itself with the watershed special permit, the Conservation Commission, the Army Corps, and the state. So we'll be coming back and hopefully get some additional funding to do the permitting, the final design, and the bidding. Okay, and we'll get that done, say, starting in July, hopefully, to about this time next year. Okay?
Okay.
Any specific questions?
Yeah, I'll go around. Bill, start with you.
Sure, so just thinking about the timeline, like, you would put in one request this year to get the drawings done?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that you could go to bid, and then you would come back next year and say, like, now we're ready to hire a construction company to do it?
Yeah, we're trying to time it so either we get, say, 100% design done and we're really sure about what the cost is going to be, because right now we'd have to add like a 30 or 50% contingency on it given the market. So either we're going to come back with that sure number or we're going to see if we can go to bid and get an actual number before. And it's difficult holding bids for a long period of time, right? So we're going to try to work that schedule out, but we'll keep you informed.
Ron, any questions?
Nope.
Tim?
I had a question on the construction of the block retaining wall. What are you looking at for, are you looking at a temporary comfort dam?
Yeah, sort of a porta dam. They make these plastic things. Yep. Yeah, we're looking at that. We're going to have to dewater out here. This is why we're really going to have to do a lot of permitting. I doubt the lake will be as low as it's been this past summer. Hopefully it's not.
What is the elevation at the wall right now?
I'm going to give you a number and I'm going to be wrong. But okay. It's like 10 feet. Above the water at this point. Yeah. So we have to go below the ground, the bed of the lake to
so
put the
bottom
foundation.
Of the wall is 10 feet above the water right now? Is that
the top of the wall?
The top of the wall.
Top of the wall. Yeah.
So you need a temporary cofferdam to be able to construct the wall.
Yeah, we'll have one all along the whole side there. Yeah. And with dewatering set up and so forth.
Derek?
With all the work the town is doing along that road, can you work with any of the permitting they've already done, or is that
it's all new? Yeah, because we did the stabilization on the road itself further up, and that was its own animal. It's right. different construction, different techniques, different issues. Yeah.
Oh, you worked on that?
Yes. Okay. Well, I was the principal. I don't really work on them. I can't take credit.
John, any questions? I know you've seen it.
Good.
You're good? Okay. I guess the only question I had is you referenced the low level of the lake currently. How far down are you designing the ramp now to accommodate rising and falling of the water?
Yeah, we do have data for dozens of years. The water department's been keeping track of and we're going to make it to the low point so that people can walk down to that point, so they're not walking in the muck and so forth.
Okay.
We'll have to work that out once the survey, gets incorporated.
Okay. And I guess just, this rendering in particular, I know it's just a rendering, but it kind of struck me. Is there any thought of a picnic area or anything like that along that?
Glad you asked, yes. At that lobe on the bottom there, we made that so that it's more, it could be like a seating area so people can enjoy the lake.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty visible. We want to make it as attractive as possible. We are going to be taking on a lot of trees that have grown into the wall there now and have destroyed the wall. But we're going to replant trees a little further back. So that's why we want to make it more natural looking, on the shoreline itself. Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. Well, I appreciate the update. I think this is kind of what we had in mind.
Yeah.
Good. Glad to hear it.
Excellent.
All right.
Thank you.
We'll be back. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Okay, next on our agenda, we have John Strauss, the chair of the Master Plan Implementation Committee. Invited him to join us this evening to discuss briefly, kind of where they're at, and as we head into our funding cycle, what guidelines or recommendations or goals they have that we should be keeping in mind as we're approving applications. So, John, if you don't mind. Are you late for surgery?
So hello, I'm John Strauss, current chairman of the Town's Master Plan Implementation Committee. Town's Master Plan was done back in, this is downtown, I'm sorry. Just about under 10 years ago now. And our committee, for those who don't know, serves as an advisory role on behalf of the town. Master plan was created, and we exist to keep check to see how the progress is going, if projects and activities within town are meeting those goals. We're kind of the measuring stick. Again, we're only in an advisory role, but within the master plan itself is 103 different outlined strategies and goals in subcategories, housing, economic development, transportation, et cetera. Our committee actually maintains a website on the town's, its own website within the town's website that basically provides a breakdown and analysis of each and every one of those goals categorized. We update it biweekly, monthly, or as information is as warranted. Again, a lot of those goals relative to the CPC activities are maintaining of public. Maintenance of open areas, development of recreational facilities, maintenance of recreational facilities, additional amenities for the citizens of the town. We just keep a current gauge on stuff like that. So
okay. So I'm not sure if anyone on the committee has specific questions for John. I wanted to at least start this open dialogue as we go through, and when we look at things like, open space, for example, right? There's a 7-point checklist that I think is a part of the master plan that says, okay, when evaluating an open space slot, how many of these boxes is a check that we can measure against? And I guess my question for you, and it's a lengthy document, do you have any other guidance for any of the other categories as well? Open space is pretty straightforward from the open space plan, but whether it's affordable housing or a recreation project, are there other ways that we should be looking at these applications?
Some are obviously far more cut and dry than others. Transportation goals are pretty clear as far as what they're looking for. Open space and recreation is, some of them are very clear cut as far as what they're looking for. Some of them are contingent on other developments, or secondary to development activities. Is there a side benefit to be realized as part of a proposed activity? So one of the things that we do is for when projects of significance come before the town, in the past what we've done is we sit down with our evaluation matrix and basically say, and you might recognize from the last town meeting, for instance, where we did an objective analysis of the proposed Royal Crest redevelopment, where we looked at that development relative to, does it meet or progress, or is it in line with what the master plan is looking to do? And we weeded out all the ones that weren't applicable, down to, I think, 13 of the 103, and said, all right, these are applicable, and do they have is the project, does that have is it affecting it positively as far as fulfilling the goals? Does it retard those goals from happening, or is there a neutral? So again, as activities are presented before us, we gauge whether, is it something that needs a deep dive by us, or is it, yes, it's meeting those goals.
So. Right. I mean, I think that makes sense. I think we probably keep the master plan in the back of our mind when we're looking at each of these projects. But I wasn't sure if you guys were independently evaluating projects. But it sounds like it's when things come to you.
Yeah, I mean, we try to stay abreast of anything that's going. We work hand in hand with Gene, so along with Andrew Shapiro. So anything that's coming across the table, we're privy to, and then it's a question of, is it not necessarily, is it worthy of our deep dive into it, but for certain projects, we've taken that, about three or four of them at this point. So
okay, all right, excellent. Does anyone have any other questions for John?
No, I think it's great, and I just pulled up the date, so it was 2018, so 5 years ago.
Okay. So 16 came to mind, but that's...
Yeah. I think the open space plan is 16, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, because I looked at it earlier today.
Okay. So, yeah. All right, John, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you for having
Appreciate
me.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank
you. All right. Okay, moving right along. Next up, we have our notice of intent of applications. This was a somewhat new process for us this year, and that we had almost kind of a pre-application to give people the opportunity to bring in projects to vet them a little further before we get to an actual application. It would have been great to have something like that for the boat ramp last year, for how many times we went back and forth. But that's what we'd like to kind of continue that process here. So is Amy presenting anything on hers? Or that'd be great. Yeah, we'll start with that one, and then Stan will go to you. Yeah. Sure, I got the right one up.
All right, so nope. Zero Bradford Street is a 6.8-acre parcel that's situated directly between Carter Hill Fields and Mezarenko Farm. It's privately owned today. It's on the market for just under $1 million. The listing notes that it's potentially a two-lot. It could be divided into two lots. So we have contracted with Landvest. We've had an appraisal done. The appraisal came back at only $510,000 because they don't believe it can be divided into two lots, primarily because it would require septic. There are wetlands along the roadway. According to the watershed bylaw, no septic can be constructed within 150 feet of those wetlands, and so that kind of pushes it up some pretty steep topography to the rear of the lot. And so we have made an offer based on that appraisal at 510. That's being worked through with town council at this point, so I don't have an answer on that offer. But we have, at this point, with a lot of contingencies, including suitable soils for a septic system.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Great. Any questions for Gene?
I mean, just an observation is that if you look at...
Can you speak into the mic, please? Yeah. Thank you.
Is that back, we purchased Mazarenko property probably about 25 years ago. Might even be closer to 30. And then Carter Hill was the very first property that we purchased as part of CPA in the very first year. And I believe that parcel there was owned by the same family that owned Carter Hill. Okay. And we always knew we wanted to get that because it's obviously between two open space parcels that we own. It's in the watershed. It's a steep slope. It hits all of the characteristics. So I'm really glad we're doing this. So, yeah.
Great. I think Amy made note that it checks, I think, five of the seven criteria.
So the listings you had of the seven, five of them check the box on this parcel.
Excellent. Do you expect to hear back from the seller prior to the application deadline?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Bill?
Yeah, so who would own the property and who would hold the conservation restriction?
So the town would own it under care, custody, control of the Conservation Commission, and Greenbelt will hold the CR. Greenbelt actually came to us really early on in this process.
Okay. All right. So, and could you give a little background? How does Greenbelt usually, how do they come into play with this?
In terms of, it's just a priority parcel on their list.
On
as
their,
well.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I mean, the one, I think, difference now than it used to be is that in the past, when we first started procuring property under CPA, the Trust for Public Land actually came in, purchased the property, and then sold it to the town, incurred all the cost along the way. And I think for about four projects, they did that. Over the last 10 years, Greenbelt has played a little bit of that role, because if you think about the Leonard Farm and the Glennie Woodlot, they came in and acted as the intermediary. In this case, I think it's a little bit different because the town is the primary agent and Greenbelt is assisting because they know a lot about how to manage these types of things, but the role will be a little bit less. It'll just be to hold the CR. So,
yeah. So would that be consistent with the two abutting parcels where town owns and does Greenbelt hold?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's the same way.
Yeah.
I assume
I'm not
that,
sure if Greenbelt holds the CRs of both of them, but
okay.
It is town owned.
Yeah,
okay,
they're both town owned. Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah. All right. And there is existing trails or plan to.
There are no existing trails. It's pretty steep topography in there,
okay.
But there certainly could be trails.
Okay. Okay. All right. Terrific. Any other questions for Gene? All right.
Good.
Thank you. Next up, we have Stan Limpert from the Historic Society, who's got actually two notices of intent in.
Mind if I sit down?
By all means.
We've submitted, the Historical Society has submitted, if you will, two letters of intent, one for artifacts restoration and the second for interior restorations in the Parson Barnard House. Let me speak to the artifacts restoration. You all may or may not be aware that we have had artifacts stored in the basement of the Grange for a number of years, maybe, I don't even know. Predates me, maybe 20 years. And as we started to take action to try to sell that property, we realized we had to get that stuff out of there. So we moved it all out of the basement, and it turned out that it needed a lot of help. It hadn't been taken very good care of, and so we have a lot of materials that need to be restored in some way or another. A lot of the materials that were in the basement were in fact what we would call textiles, garments. And a lot of them, you know, didn't do too well. So we're in the process of starting that restoration, but we need some help to do that. And that's what this grant is. It's to provide some materials to help us with that restoration, and also to provide some expert assistance in actually restoring some of that material. So that's what that grant application is for. The Parson Barnard House, as you all know, you know, we've received over a number of years some grants to help with the house and the barn. You know, we got a new roof, we got some other work done on the house, But the one thing that we have not been able to fund over the years, and now has gotten to the point where we really need to do something about it, is the interior of the historic part of the building. This all came to light when we got a new caretaker there a couple of years ago. We hadn't, you know, the same person had been doing that for a long time, and we hadn't thought much about it. But when we got the new caretaker, they started taking a much more detailed view of what was needed on the interior there and what we needed to be thinking about to sort of stop some of the deterioration that is going on. Interior brickwork in the fireplaces, paint, woodwork, and there's even holes in the wall that we need to think about filling. So we just haven't had the funds to be able to do that ourselves, so that's what this grant application is for, is to provide the funding to actually go through room by room and start some restoration of the interior of the building. The exterior is actually in pretty good shape. You know, it's been painted, we put a new roof on, it's probably okay, but we now need to work on the interior to really make sure that it doesn't deteriorate any further than it already has. So that's okay. What that grant application is for. So
okay.
Questions?
Any questions? We'll start this side.
Stan, the master plan that we had done back, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago,
yep.
when we funded a few projects, yep. are we through all the projects on that list? I'm just trying to understand how this stacks up against what might not be done on that list.
I don't know that there was a lot for the interior of the building. A lot of those tasks were exterior oriented,
yeah.
you know, like the roof and painting and stuff. So I don't think we paid that much attention to the interior in that plan. But there were some things on there, and this sort of is trying to finish up some of those, that tasking that we've, you know, that we've had. But I don't think there was a lot of detail in that plan about doing the interior.
No, but I guess my point is, I assume then that this is your highest priority, that this is the most important.
Well, certainly the preservation of that building is, yeah. yes, it's right up there at the top of the
yeah.
list, right. Absolutely. There's no, that and the artifacts. I mean, that's what we do. That's, you know, that's the historic stuff that we're trying to preserve yeah. for the community. So this is right at the top of our list. And we want to, you know, we have the opportunity now. We have people in place who can help do this if we have the funds to make it work. So, you know, we have a new curator, archivist, that's been working for us for 6 months, and she's very good and very active and has done a lot to start this process. But now if we can help with some funding, we can really sort of start to make some headway on the artifacts, as well as having people now that will help us start to look at the interior of the Carson Barnard House and start to do some restoration there. As a matter of fact, the person we would have do that is the person who's now the caretaker, who is not quite a restoration carpenter, but that's what he does. He's a carpenter. So he would be doing some of that work too. So. More
Gary?
Questions?
I don't know.
Rick?
What type of artifacts are you intending to remove?
Well, there's, like I said, there were a lot of textiles, a lot of clothing, right? And there are also a lot of objects. There's a lot of tools, old tools, toys, all kinds of things. And they all need to be gone over. A lot of them have mold. They may have issues associated with them. And we've been very careful. Our archivist, our curator, has been very careful about quarantining the materials. So they, you know, you keep stuff that has mold on it away from the good stuff. So it's a, you know, there's a whole process that we're going through to make sure that the stuff is clean. The textiles have been a much more complicated problem. And initially when we had them, when we took them out of the Grange, we didn't have space yet to store them ourselves. So we put them in a storage unit in South Lawrence. Well, it turned out that may or may not have been a good thing, because when we took them out of the unit, we found out there were insects in a lot of the clothing. So that shocked everybody. So the solution for that was we got a couple of freezers and we froze everything. So you take the stuff and you freeze it. That kills the insects,
yep.
right? Then you can take it out and see if they're too damaged to save, or if you can, you know, clean them and vacuum, you know, so we do. So that's the process that we're going through. But now we've gotten to the point where we need to think about the actual conservation of some pretty nice, if you saw some of the stuff we've got, it's pretty interesting. We've got, you know, uniforms, but you got a lot of good stuff. But we want to make sure it's well preserved so we can keep it around for a long time. And so now that we have it in a place where we can start to really work on that, that's, we want to pursue that sort of actively now. So anyway, more questions?
Tim?
On the painting of the Parson Barnard House.
Yeah.
Does that get into a rat nest of lead paint where you have to then, once you start, you can't stop?
Certainly that's going to be an issue, but I'm not sure that that's going to be a major concern, because we can probably try to seal that off. You know, it's not like people actually live in the house, right? It's, you know, it's an occasional use building.
Oh, okay. I thought someone actually lived there. I'm sorry.
On that side, we deal with the lead. Okay, so there's the caretaker's part.
Right.
And that's dealt with totally separately, right? This is on the historic side. So we can deal with that a little bit differently, because it's an occasional use thing. You know, you don't have children living, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So there's, you know, to the extent that we need to deal with that issue, we will. But it's not exactly the same as those, as if someone was living
there
in the house. So, just saying. Something else?
I think you implied an answer to this, but I wanted to double check. So do you have someplace to store it, these artifacts, once they're restored?
Yes. Yes, we have, you know, in the new Stevens Center.
That's where they'll go.
You know, we have a large space. We have one whole upstairs wing that's storage. That's, so we've got that all set, ready to go. We need some of the materials that we're requesting in this grant to make better use of that space, but we have enough space to store this. Now we do, right?
Great.
And so we're fortunate in that way. In addition to that, you know, as you may or may not be aware, we have the complete basement of that building, which we have now brought to a state where it probably could be used for storage if we had to, particularly for not textiles, but 3D objects, you know. We've really gotten the humidity and the water problem down to pretty much nothing in the basement now. So that's another enormous part of the facility that could be used for additional storage if we ever needed it. So,
Bill, any questions for you?
And then, I was just wondering about like a assessment, like how are you go about sort of the assessment before the work starts?
Well, we're going to have to get some folks in to help us in the Parson Barnard House, for example, with
that's
paint,
a, yeah, that that's what I was thinking about.
Stuff. Mm-hmm. So we'll have to find some experts that can help us determine how best to deal with the paint in a historical way. The woodwork, not so much, but we're mostly concerned about the paint to make it appropriate for that. On the artifact side, we are going to get some people in to help us do assessments primarily of the textiles, the clothing, because some of them may not be worth trying to restore. You know, it could be extremely expensive to restore some of the clothing. And so it may not be, we may not be able to just afford to do it. So we're going to have somebody help us make an assessment. We have some experts that we can call on to help us go through the textiles. The 3D objects, not so much. You know, that's more a matter of, you know, cleaning and whatever minor restoration we need to do there. So those are a little bit different. But it's mostly the textiles where we're going to need some help in terms of expertise to make sure that there are things that we can afford to restore. So, anyway.
Mm-hmm. How often is the Parson Barnard House open to the public currently?
Well, in the summertime, it's open once a month, right? And during the winter, it's open off sometimes for special occasions. I mean, people have had events in there. We haven't had any, you know, the COVID thing sort of changed our schedule, but they were having ghost things, you know, in the Parson Barnard, you know, groups would come and I don't know what they were doing exactly, but they would come and pay money and look for ghosts or something. I don't know exactly, but so we had some occasions to do that, and from time to time we do have school groups that come and do programs in the Parson Barnard House, but it typically open. I think it would be at least five times in the summer, okay. Five Saturdays.
In the next slide, how all you think it would have to be closed for restoration? Is that the anticipation?
It's not really clear. We might, do it sort of room at a time so we could, still have the house open. But, we'll see how that goes as far as we'd like to continue to have, it available to the community in the summertime so people can come and visit it, so we'd like to avoid closing it entirely. That would be not a good thing. So we'd figure something out how to do that. So anyway, more questions?
I think we've got everything.
Good. Okay.
Thank you, Stan. All right, next up we'll have Tom Perrone in the Middlewood Tot Lot. Just make your name and address for the record.
Sure. Good evening. My name is Tom Perrone, and I live at 65 Meadowood Road, and I'm representing the residents of the Meadowood neighborhood, which represents the over 90 homes on Meadowood and Buckland and Peterson and Nadine and a stretch of the Andover Bypass. And Brian is the chair. Chair Roach has pulled up the map here. And the tot lot is a small green space that represents it's a little tiny space between 64 and 66 Meadowood Road. So it's a little tiny green space. And I'd like to give you a little bit of history about the tot lot first before going into the proposal, and you can see it here on this presentation. As I mentioned, it represents about 90 homes that are all walkable to this little park. And when these homes were built, most of them around the early 90s, they put in a place structure in that, and it was installed about in 1993. I was not a resident at the time, but it's my understanding that that was the original structure. I moved in 2008, and that structure remained until about 2015. In 2015, the residents raised their own money to put in a new structure that was more on the lines of what you'd put in your backyard rather than something that you would think is appropriate for a town park. But that's what we did. That was the money that we had. As you also probably know, and those that are involved in playground master plan, these structures have a finite lifetime, right? And that span could be, depending on weather and other factors, somewhere between 6 and 10 years. And we're kind of at that point now where it's time to think about that in order to maintain this play structure that's safe for the residents. I think all of you, especially those that have been in town and raised your kids in town, know how important it is for us to have places for young people to go and get some exercise. And I really appreciate the work that you're doing as a committee to support that. In the current space, the current tot lot, there is no seating either for people to bring their kids and then have a place to sit down while their kids are playing on the structure. So in our view, it's time to consider a new structure and to put in some benches. And what we've done is put together a high-level estimate. I've never done this before. I'm a chemist by training. So I look to you as the committee if there are things that are missing or are too low, too high, et cetera. I very much welcome your feedback in how we would put together a proposal that would be appropriate for the kinds of things you've seen done before in the town. So I want to thank you in advance for that. Next slide, please. So what's being proposed here is a $35,000 grant that would cover both the play structure, its installation, and installation of some park benches within the tot lot. I should also mention that this particular green space, since I've been living in the house directly across the street, has been maintained by the residents. It's not owned or maintained or, sorry, scratch the word owned. It's not maintained by the town, with exception of one year that there may have been some wood chips that were provided by the town to go around the structure. But since I've lived there in 2008, I've mowed the lawn, I've trimmed the bushes. Sometimes we've done some light repairs and things of the structures themselves. And we'd really like to have a discussion around, is that the best way to move forward with this little gem that we call the tot lot? So as I mentioned, this proposal is meant to ask for the funding to buy a play structure, to install it professionally, and to install park benches. And our intention would be that if, in fact, this committee agrees that this is a go forward, that I would assemble a small committee within our neighborhood to get a detailed quote of exactly what type of a structure we want to put up, because there are probably hundreds of different designs, to spec that out, and then to provide a timeline, a detailed timeline of what that project looks like. I've taken a wild guess at what that might be in the next slide. My experience with trying to get windows for my house during COVID, we've now been waiting 13 months. So I have no idea if there's a lead time of any significant nature for this type of equipment at the, you know, and you folks who have done this might know, but I've made assumption that it's readily available. So I guess I'll stop there. The next slide on the presentation is just a few pictures that I'm sure you folks have had a chance to take a look at. This tot lot's it's you know located within walkable distance, and as I mentioned, it serves about 90 homes in the Meadowood area. And I certainly appreciate all the work that you, as a committee, have done to consider this application.
Thanks. Thank you, Tom. I guess I'll want to make some clarifying points on, I guess you referenced the ownership of the lot, right?
Yeah.
This is where things may get a little bit murky with
Understood.
This particular parcel. I'm sure there's folks here who know more about this than I do in terms of when this subdivision was approved and what was left over. It's almost like a little bit of an orphaned parcel.
Sure.
So can you speak to the existence or lack thereof of a neighborhood association?
Sure. Thanks for that. I'm not an attorney, so if I've said something that suggests I understand the legal status of this parcel, I want to be very clear. I am not an attorney, and I have no official background in making any statements about ownership. Since I've lived in that house that is directly about at 10 o'clock, as you look at that picture, at 65 directly across the street, there's been no direct town maintenance of that, with the exception of the mention of the wood chips. The town comes and they plow that little road that you might see, that little white that's a boat right there. They plow that little stretch right there, but that's the extent that the town does anything. And since we've lived in the house directly across the street, where that 02501050000.0, that's the house that I live in, there has never been any homeowner association. The only thing we have is a group chat, a group email that we all communicate when we want to share, hey, my dryer went down, who do I go call to fix it, right? So there isn't, to the best of my knowledge. I am aware that at some point there was mention in some of the legal documents there was an association, but I have never seen since 2008 anything active. So if there is a discussion of ownership, then I would defer to you folks of how we proceed.
Yeah, I make a comment, and then I'd like to ask Gene a question, because I think we need to do that. I vaguely remember now, originally when we did the subdivision there, there was a residual lot, which is this, that I think we held for that specific purpose. What I forget is what the governance of that was, whether we specifically in the subdivision decision said that it was to be conveyed eventually to homeowners association. If you go back to the prior slide, it looks like I'm going to bet it's still owned by the developer, but Gene, I think we probably need to check that to find out, you know, who owns it and what the subdivision decision said, because I forget.
The master declaration that envisions someday potentially conveying it to the town, but the street has never been accepted. And so the master declaration, I highlighted two sides where it references the tot lot, and it envisions upon street acceptance, including potentially the tot lot, it could be conveyed to the town, but it hasn't been.
So
this is the one legal document.
If the road hasn't been accepted, is there still a bond out?
There is still a bond, and approximately $15,000, which is what we used to hold for street acceptance. It costs a bit more than that now, so I think they've upped it to roughly $50,000 now in order to get the as-built. It was brought to town meeting. I found the Warren article. but it wasn't accepted. There was there was several streets at that time in that same warrant article, and only one or two of those got accepted. Some of the, there's four, if I remember right, Buckland, Peterson, Meadowood, and
Nadine.
And I think two of the four are accepted, and the other two are not, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. Can you clarify what that means in layman's terms? Are those town roads not considered town roads from a maintenance ownership liability perspective, or what is it? Does that mean?
So they're not accepted by the town. So you mentioned being plowed.
Yes.
The town is still plowing roads that haven't been accepted.
Yes.
They do trash pickup and things like that. But technically, town meeting is the one that accepts roads, and this hasn't gone through that process.
Okay.
And the developer is the one that, in the decision, there's a clause that you bring it through town meeting for acceptance.
Got it. Is that a difficult process, or is that a relatively easy process? Sorry to ask the $25 million question.
Given it's been 22 years, and I don't think the developer's in the area anymore. So we can talk offline if you'd like to about that. But
right. Because it would be my personal recommendation that it is a gem of a place that I would think the town would want to maintain. Especially if you're agreeing to give money to put a structure there, I would think that that would signal that you understand the value of that. I know the residents would agree. Now, I don't mind mowing the lawn and trimming the hedges, but, you know, it's more than that, or it could be. And just in full transparency, that lot is right adjacent to the conservation land. And to the best of my knowledge, there's never been any like encroachment or any build out or any intention to do anything except to leave it in the same footprint.
I guess we'll continue with any kind of questions. I just kind of want to highlight, this is the kind of project that this process, Snows of Intent process, I think was intended to kind of catch, right? So we can run through some of these traps before you get through a formal application process. So
okay.
I think, you know, our goal would be to say, here are the questions that we're going to need answered.
That's right.
In order to, you know, be able to make, come to judgment on this recommendation for town meeting. So
right. I guess maybe a kind of a decision tree question would be, does the ownership piece have to be sorted before this committee can make a decision on the funding of a structure? And if so, then that helps in terms of the timing. If
in a technical sense, no, but I think we'd probably want it to
I
be.
I think, given the circumstances here, yes. Given the context, I mean, I think you're exactly right. Technically, you don't, but I think you would, given the totality of this.
Okay. Well, I can certainly speak for the residents that we're eager to work with the town and provide whatever quotes, if that's something that helps, or any other pieces that we can do. If it involves, you know, $1 million worth of attorney fees, I'm not sure how that would proceed, right?
Yeah.
It was hard enough to get $6,000 to put in the current play structure on a GoFundMe site, so.
Gene, is the GIS inaccurate?
I believe it is, because you brought up that yellow highlighted lot on the original subdivision plan. So it was one of the lots on the plan.
Okay. I can't even tell where the lot lines are, but okay.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Does anyone else have any other questions for Mr. Perrone? I do have a couple of things I'd like to.
Okay. Very much.
I have a comment, and please do not take the comment in the wrong vein, because it's, I think it's one of the considerations you have to do when you bring a proposal like this to town meeting. The question will be, who benefits? 90 people. Where's the skin in the game? I don't think there's any way this goes forward unless a good chunk of the money gets paid for by the people that live there, either directly or through sweat equity. I mean, and I don't say it to be difficult or mean, but I say practically speaking, you're asking to confer a benefit that's not a direct public benefit. It's a benefit just to the people that live in the neighborhood. And, you know, again, it's just, that's the way people react. And so, you know, and I'm not trying to be difficult. I think what you're doing is great or anything, but that is just one of the things a lot of people will say.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do want to clarify that it is 90 homes rather than 90 people, but your point is still valid that there may be a perception out there, at least that's what you're telling me, that their perception would be this is for the people that live within walking distance. We do see, you know, a small number of people that pull their cars up and they park there, but generally
yeah.
It's people that live in the neighborhood that walk there to the park.
Yeah.
And, you know, certainly I know for myself, the people that are interested in moving into the neighborhood find that to be an attraction.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But certainly we will do whatever we need to do to answer any of the questions that you yeah. might have and take recommendations under advisement if there's something we should do.
Yeah. I think the question that I would want to see answered as well, in addition to sorting out ownership, is what's the future? How are we protecting the investment
sure.
of the taxpayers in terms of, you know, how do we make sure that it doesn't fall into disrepair
right.
in 5 years?
Yeah. Again, I'm not an attorney or a town planner, but my personal view is that we would consider how to get this into the playground master plan so that it gets the refresh like all other town parks would get.
Yeah, you could. I mean, that's an interesting perspective because you could make the argument that we should convey this to the town and it should be a town property, and that gets a little bit around the optics question that
correct.
I raised.
Correct.
So, you know, fair enough. Yeah.
Yeah, and I have no idea if that's a big request or a small one. I have no concept of
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
I like that path. The other thing just to point out is that corner of the town is sort of isolated, whereas all the other parks we've seen are, you know, right around this neck of the woods kind of thing. That one has, it doesn't, I didn't even know that existed.
Maybe right, right.
Drive by there.
That's why I put some pictures in the map in there, because I'm
yeah.
sure that most people drive by Merrimack and the old Rite Aid and have no idea that we even live back there, you know.
Yeah. But I do like the idea that going through the town playground master plan
yeah.
path might be the way to go if
yeah.
you can sort out the ownership.
Yeah, again, I don't know what's involved, and if you have recommendations, I certainly would love to hear that.
Yeah, I can't say that I do off the top of my head, but I think this is the kind of thing that we'll continue to do some homework on our end and figure out if there is a path
right.
in time for, you know, this year's funding cycle and everything else, because
right.
it may require more legwork than that.
Understood.
You know, but I think yeah. you've raised an interesting point. I think, Tim, your point was well taken, right? There's no parks that the kids in this neighborhood can ride their bikes too, other than this one. So
no.
I think that's a valid point. So,
and I think you got a good offer with Jean having an offline conversation with her. I think she's going to solve a lot of your questions.
I very much appreciate that. Thank you.
Employee of the year.
Awesome.
Brushes on.
You earned my vote.
All right.
Thank you.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Close that down. All right. Next up, we have Zero Boston Hill Road. Mr. Willis.
Good evening. My name's Gene Willis. Thank you for the opportunity for dialogue. Like some of you members on the committee, I was born and raised in this town. I was at the town meeting when it voted for the adoption of the Community Preservation Act. The open space aspect of the legislation was a major impetus for the townspeople to vote to accept this act. I have a project that meets this criteria. It's a 38-acre parcel with road frontage on town water and sewer. Two separate engineering firms have determined that it could be developed into 188 residential units under the North Andover zoning bylaws. I would like very much for this land to remain in its natural state. The only way that can happen is if it's acquired by the town or some conservation organization like the trustees. Absent that, some venture capital developer will come in and put the land to private use in multi-unit residential. That may be its highest and best use, but I want to offer it to the town first at a discount. So, Jeannie, if you could put up the assessor's map for me. Thank you. Just to give you a little background as to locations and stuff. Boy, I can't see that. I'm going to need to get closer just so you can see where we're talking about. Can you make that any bigger?
I don't know that I
okay, well,
can too much. Yeah.
Me here
I could do it on GIS if you on
well,
this.
Just someplace I can see it. So I can. If I sit here, probably this mic works.
Yeah. Yep, it does. Yep.
Okay. So
yep. So can you see? Can you not see this? Or?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Great. Yeah. I'm looking. I thought you meant over here. Yeah, okay. Great. Okay. Yeah. This is good. All right. Thanks very much. Yeah. So, to orient you on where the property is. Thanks, Gene. That's good. It's off of Gray Street and back behind Boston Hill Road. Okay. Basically, I'm sorry I shake, but basically the property is like this and comes down Stiles Street here like this. This is Stiles Street, which is a paper undeveloped road or whatever you want to call it, but it's not developed. There is a sewer brought to the property right here, gravity sewer. There is a water main and hydrant brought to the property right here. And there's an approved subdivision plan number 1571 at the registry that shows a cul-de-sac right here. The North Andover Improvement Society owns a large tract of parcel here that's open space. I believe it's here. The Charles Ward Reservation is all up in here. It's 700 acres surrounding on three sides this property. There's one other privately owned parcel in here owned by the Lullis Brothers Construction of Lynn. It's a 14 acre parcel off of Stiles Street, and it's this parcel here. Its only access is available down Stiles Street. The parcel I'm offering to the town here is part of this package. Has the fee interest to the land under the street, so that the owner of this parcel owns the, whatever you want to call the street itself or the land under the street. So I've been told by attorneys that the DeLullis Brother property could not be, the Stiles Street could not be widened or developed or paved without the participation of the owner of that first parcel on the left. Okay. I have a 3-minute video I'd like to show for you so that you can actually see. It starts on the paper street, Stiles Street, runs down Stiles Street, then comes into here, goes into this field, which is part of the parcel. Then we walk up through this property. And if you don't mind, Jeannie, can you play that?
I think, Mr. Wills, we'll skip the video. It is in the packet.
3 minutes? Okay. Would I like the residents to see it also?
It's publicly available in the meeting packet, so people can access it if they wish. So
3-minute video?
I believe I'll have to download it first.
Well,
I'm not buying anything. Seems to be giving me an error message here, sir. But I will say, everyone in the community does have access
but
to that.
I would like the public to also see it.
Public has access to it via the website. I'm sorry, I'm unable to do that. So
I tried to. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Right.
Okay. Gene, could you put up the trustees?
I'm in control of the computer. You can ask me.
I'm sorry. I thought Gene.
No, it's sorry.
In our emails, Gene said she ran it.
So I've got it right here.
My bad.
Yep.
Okay, thanks. So this is the trustees of the reservation trail map. The property, the locust abuts on the Boston Hill Road side. And I can't.
Mr. Wilson, I think you're talking about right here.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so that's the locus of property right there?
Yeah.
Okay, so the property is here, and it runs down through Stiles Street and comes to Gray Street. It's 38 acres. If you notice this blue line, this is the Vetter Trail from the trustee's property. It runs right along the property line of this 38-acre parcel. As it is now, people from this part of town do walk down Style Street and actually walk through my property to get to the trustees, to get up to Elephant Rock, if you're familiar with this parcel, it's up there. So it would be a big enhancement to the trail network and walkability. So we've met with the town manager and are engaged in negotiating an agreement with the trustees of the reservation. The trustees are strongly interested in working with the town on this parcel because it abuts their 700-acre Charles Ward Reservation. We would like to apply to the CPC for acquiring this property under open space. We're working with the trustees of the reservation and the town. The organization applying will be determined in time for the application deadline. So, to summarize, the property's use, two separate engineering firms, Christensen and Sergi of Haverhill, and Moore and Cameron Group Incorporated of Danvers, has determined under the continuing care retirement community regulations in the town bylaws, it would qualify for 188 residential units. That does not include the 14 acres of the Lullis Brothers property, but just fits the property, the 38 acres that I'm proposing. There is municipal water, a main and hydrant installed on the property. There's a sewer main installed to the property. There's an improved subdivision plan, and the property is also accessed by a town-maintained road, Boston Hill Road. The price. An appraisal done last year is in possession of the planning department as part of my application last year. I've hired a second appraisal firm previously used by the town of Andover to value this property that they have purchased in the past. That the town of Andover has used to value property that they have purchased. It's anticipated that a value from this appraisal will be available in time for the February 2nd application deadline. I'll provide that appraisal to the committee when it's complete. I realize the committee is limited to expenditures of what their own appraisal justifies. The terms. I'll sell the property to a conservation organization for less than full appraised value. Payment can be made to me in installments with no interest. And I'm open to other suggestions that may help this project happen and would appreciate the committee's input. Thank you for your time. I'd appreciate any help you can give me. And I do want to contact John. I'm glad we're here because I think going to John would be a good person, right? You're the master plan person?
He chairs the master plan committee.
Yes. John. So I'd like to reach out. I'd like to reach out to you in the near future and talk to you about this.
Okay. All right. Any questions for Mr. Willis? Bill, start with you.
Sure. So you've had this property on the market at all?
No.
Has Avalon Bay come and asked you about the property?
No, I've had letters sent to me, et cetera, et cetera.
Has Related Beal or anybody, any of the big developers in Massachusetts, have they come to you about this parcel?
No, just cold call. Hey, we see you have property. I mean, letters or whatever. We see you have property. Right. We're very interested in talking with you, but I'm not interested in talking at this point. So I just.
Yeah, I've spoken to some members of the trustees about this property, and they have said, yes, we do like where it is. They have also said that they don't think that the market value is anywhere near the $4 million sort of level, and we are constrained by those sorts of things. And as I look at the other open space purchases that we've made, you know, across town, in terms of, you know, price per acre, I don't see anything, you know, sort of remotely close. I took a walk through the property a few weeks ago on a good cold day. It was nice, and I came in from the Boston Hill side, and I kind of circled the property and walked, and it does seem that, like, I can see where you locate the buildings is good and high land, and then I see it sort of tails off, and I don't know the wetland state down there, but it didn't look like sort of, objectively from a you know, from a viewing perspective, developable land. I know from the Style Street side, it's a little harder, was a little harder to access because I thought that was actually private property. I drove around, but I didn't want to drive up there because it looked like I'd be driving on somebody's driveway, and I didn't think that was appropriate, and I wasn't sure. But to me, that's where a lot of this seems to be, that I don't, you know, I certainly think it's at a nice spot. It's, you know, a nice piece of property. It would serve conservation interests, but those are things that I don't see. I don't see the value of the land in that way. I don't see the same sort of obvious path to development. It doesn't seem that any of the people who make money day in and day out by developing parcels of land have aggressively pursued it. And so, you know, of course, we would wait and see how assessments and negotiations and so forth go on. But those, you know, those are the same things that I was thinking and the same questions that we've been asking over the, you know, I guess this is my fifth year in the committee, over the years that we've discussed this. And so, you know, I'm still probably in the same place where I was before.
I understand that, and I'm totally with you. The only reason I have that number is that's the only commercial appraisal I have, and I've submitted it. I've never had a chance to have this dialogue. I'm open for dialogue with this. We've talked to the trustees. They've told us we need an appraisal to do due diligence. We told them that's okay. We're good with that. Do it. We know that you, as a committee, needs an appraisal on this property, and you're limited to that. We're okay, and we're good with that. But I haven't even had a chance to have this dialogue. That's what I'm trying to make this work. I've told you, I don't expect to sell it for appraised value. And again, that the only reason that number is there is because I paid a commercial real estate appraiser 56-page report that documented how and why it's worth that. That's why that number's there. To get in the same ballpark or zip code, I've hired another firm that the town of Andover has used. It takes a 6-month lead time. So he says he hopes to have a value for me, and then the actual appraisal soon thereafter, and I'll submit it to the committee then too. But that being said, there's two more. The trustees aren't going to buy it unless their appraisal makes it worthwhile. And then you can't spend the money unless your appraisal. I'm just trying to have a dialogue. I want this to remain in its natural state. The only way that will happen is if the town or an organization owns it. If it goes to a private developer, then he's going to put it in use. And so that's, I'd like to have that dialogue, and thank you for this opportunity to have that dialogue.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have had the dialogue over the years when we've said, like, you should come back with a partner like Essex Greenbelt or the trustees of reservation, and I'm glad to hear that you're engaged in those discussions because I think those are the groups that will give us things.
The question I wanted to ask is, when you submit an application, is the application coming from you or is it coming from the Greenbelt? And if it doesn't come from, I mean, Greenbelt or
Trustees,
what are you going to do?
See, I've been confused on this point, and we've met with town manager, and I've been trying to figure out how this is or who this is. If it's not going to be the town or the trustees, then there won't be an application. I understand fully that I can't apply. I'm not going to be the applicant.
Okay.
We met with town manager, and there's two issues that they're talking about around open space. Open space can purchase open space land or recreational land. If it's open space land, it can, for passive recreation, it's restricted with a covenant. If it's open space purchased at the recreational use, whereas maybe you can put a ball field on it or something, then it doesn't have that restriction on it. And from what I understand from the committee, in that case, one person can own it, right? The town could own that. But if it's going to be a conservation property, then somebody owns it and somebody owns the restriction.
Still, whether it's recreation or not, you still need a CR on the property.
I don't know, whatever it needs to be. But my point being, we're talking to the town, we're talking to the trustees, and if it doesn't work, I'm trying to make this work. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, and you won't get an application, which unfortunately is 2 weeks from now, but we're working on it. And that's, we're working with the town. Town manager said she'd talk around. Did she speak? Okay. So she said she'd talk around and get back to us. We've talked to the trustees. I told them we're having this meeting. Yep. I'll get back to them, say we had this meeting, and we'll go forward. And hopefully by February 2, we'll have something. Yep. But I do fully understand that you guys are limited by what your appraisal says to us, you know. And to be quite frank with you, I was.
I get it. Sir, you can identify yourself if you'd like.
You don't mind? All right, well, I just would like to say to your point. But
could you identify yourself, name and address, please?
My name is Matthew Willis, 100 Longwood Avenue here in North Andover, a resident, and Gene's brother. The 4.4 million tag, which, again, he's just saying is a broad number at the moment, that works out to be about 88,000 per acre. The proposal that you guys are looking at just this evening for a 6-acre parcel works out to $83,000 per acre. So it's not, this is not a overly expensive project.
Thank you, Matt, for that input. And okay, I don't think that's too much minutia at this point. I think we understand that either it can work or it won't. And I understand your limitations. I'm just explaining to you where that $4.4 million came from. It was a $4,500 commercial appraisal, 59 pages, all of the, you can go through it, three scenarios. And it's supposedly the highest and best use. That's the number they came up with. There'll be another one. Trustees will have one. You'll have one. Again, I just would like to see this land remain in its natural state. If I'm 70 years old, my kids are on the West Coast, they don't want it. If I sell it to anybody, it's going to be put in private use. And if it's put in private use, for whatever, it's not going to be trees and grass. That's my intent. I was born in town. Property's been in my family for a long time. I'd like to see it remain undeveloped. But again, I can't afford to grow trees on it forever. It's going to take either the town through some vehicle or conservation or a private owner. If a private owner owns it, he's going to put it to use. And I prefer not to see that happen. And so if we can have a dialogue, that'd be great.
Yeah. Any other questions for Mr. Willis? Comments? Terry?
If your intent was to keep it open space, why would you bring water and sewer to it?
At the time, I was a lot younger and didn't know what was the future was happening. The sewer was a serendipity of, and if you want to get into that, the sewer was a serendipity of, I was up there, my mother-in-law's house was for sale. I bought it, part of the estate and everything. That needed to go for sale. The septic system was in failure. They were bringing sewer across 114 up Boston Street to service some private things. At that point in time, I ponied onto that sewer and extended the gravity sewer up Boston Hill Road, because if I had to put a septic system in there, it would have been a 35 grand put in the ground and thrown away. So because it was just serendipity that they were installing the gravity line to the bottom of Boston Hill Road, I paid the extra money to bring it up to take care of the issue for a septic system on that house that needed to be sold. And then in future, knowing that I had 38 acres out there, the sewer would be there. In reference to water main and hydrant, that's a reason why, and John could speak to this better, that's a reason why the subdivision is still valid. The town required me.
With all due respect, the subdivision is gone. You can't build on it. It's expired by now.
Okay, that I appreciate that, John. Let me explain why the water main's there. The water main was mandated at, there was a 9-acre parcel that I wanted to give my brother a 1-acre buildable lot back in 2003. At the time, planning said you can't, it's a subdivision, you need to go through the full subdivision process, which we did. $30,000 worth of engineering, full-blown subdivision, 5 pages, submitted it to planning. John was on the board. At the time, the DPW made me put the water main in and the hydrant in. That's in place. So that's why your water and hydrant is there at that point. The town made me put that in. The town planning board said, we will waive the construction, but you can look at the decision. But if anything further out happens, this cul-de-sac needs to be built. So that's why I say that that subdivision or plan is still valid. I realize that over 8 years it isn't, but because I've been told by my attorney, because there's infrastructure put in place, and because the planning board specifically mandated in their order, anything further happens, this cul-de-sac must be bid. I submitted that in my last package. I can resubmit it. But that's my understanding of why the water's there, the subdivision off Style Street, and why the sewer got brought there.
Mr. Willis, it seems like you had some litigation in regards to this whole situation up there on Boston Hill Road. And I read it. It's a long decision. I read the entire thing. And it does seem like at least the Massachusetts Land Court, you know, in deciding against you, did say that your intent in bringing the sewer line up there was to create a developable property that, and increase the value of your land than you did it. That's kind of the conclusion of the court at the time, you know, which, and it seems that you were in litigation with the neighbors who originally accepted, and then when they fully realized the nature and extent of the easements that they had granted on the land, were unhappy and had the easements reversed, and then you sued them. So I'm just kind of curious as to, you know, the statement that the town wanted to bring the water up there and it was serendipitous that the water went up there for one house when, you know, the Massachusetts, the land court and the decision says that the size of the drainage brought up there was for a much larger than one house area. So, you know, those are some of the things that sort of give me pause as I look at this.
I appreciate the opportunity to air all of this. Then you've brought up a lot of things, so let me try to address them. That's true. I'm an engineer. I'm bringing sewer up there. I could put a septic system in the ground for $35,000, or I could bring sewer up for much more money, but I know I have 38 acres out there. So that was one put. Two, there's a disagreement on what we understood with the abutters. I obviously talked to the abutters, told them I'm bringing a sewer line up there. They knew I had 38 acres. I told them, I don't need to bring a sewer up for one house. I'm bringing it up so that it might be used in the future. After I put in a sewer and gave them sewer, they came back and said, oh, we didn't know that's what we signed, even though I'm trying to explain, okay? So they went to town. I was never informed of this, never was able to come to the town meeting and the selectmen's meeting to give my side of the town, because at the town, I thought the town should own this easement for road widening. My mistake. So the easement was in the town's name, okay, for widening. I could get into the minutia. Bottom line, yeah, the court said that, no, as a matter of fact, the court said that I should have sued the town. But I'm not even going to go there. I'm just trying to explain to you there's a lot of background to this, okay? So, yes. That was my intent to possibly, I wouldn't bring a sewer up for a septic system. So what else were your points? After the sewer was in and they signed everything and it was given to the town and it was recorded, then they come back and say, oh, we didn't know that's what we signed. There are other points.
The point on the easement was not necessarily the sewer, but the fact that the right-of-way was extended over their land that caused them to take action and try to have that reversed. So, I mean, I think...
Well, excuse me, that's what you think, but that's not the case. The easement clearly showed where the easement line was.
Who prepared the easement?
Christensen and Sergi.
Yeah. Under whose direction?
Under my direction.
As in what position, in what capacity?
As a private owner, I filed with town manager for the ethics committee, got signed off,
totally about the ethics, all of this, try to keep arm's length. So yeah, it was me because I own the property. I wasn't town, I was town engineer also at the time, but the property was there, now needed to be done. So they were running simultaneously, if you will, and I went through the full notification, whatever the ethics thing is, and I can present that to you. That was part of the case that town manager knew about it, full disclosure, Christian Street, all of that stuff. Because I'm aware of the ethics possible conflict, and I tried to address that at the time.
I mean, I would just say I have reservations.
I appreciate your opportunity to, because there are a lot of issues, and I appreciate your opportunity to explain them, and it'll be what it'll be. Thank you.
You know, again, we're not even at the application phase of this just yet. You know, that will be coming forth in the next few weeks. So
right.
I guess I did have one comment in the, or one question and a comment. How do you reconcile the value in the appraisal, you know, in the millions of dollars, versus your current assessment as undevelopable land under $100,000 in value?
Well, do you use a tax assessment for value of property? I mean, that's not a...
Why would the town classify your land as undevelopable and assess you accordingly versus if it's really worth more?
I can't speak to why the town does what, but there's obviously a circle there that shows that there's a plan there. Maybe because it's so far back, but that even the town assessor's map shows the circle of the septic. But my point is, you want to know why and how it got to that point, okay? I hired an arm's length commercial appraisal. I don't know if it's 4.4 mil. That's the number I put in because that's the number he put down. And he verified it, looked through his 59 pages of how and why he came to that number. Again, there's going to be a second appraisal.
Yep.
Now, my point is, if four appraisals say it's worth 4 million, are you folks going to say, well, we don't think it's worth that, so we're not comfortable with that? I don't know what...
No, I don't think anyone's necessarily saying that.
Okay.
Necessarily. The appraisal is the appraisal. That's the straightforward process. Whether or not we can afford or choosing to allocate that money is a different story.
Understood.
And we'll get to that point when there's an application before us. I'm just trying to reconcile the assertion initially here that this is developable land, that this could be developed for senior housing or multifamily or whatever else has been put out there,
right,
versus the fact that it's classified as undevelopable and you've been taxed as such as undevelopable land. So that's what I'm just trying to reconcile. So
I can't speak to the tax assessor's means and methods.
Okay.
I can tell you again, two separate engineering firms have put up conceptual design drawings under the town's, now, it will require construction of roads.
Yep.
And under a CCRC, it's a different process. They're not town main, they're not built to town spec. They're private roads, like Edgewood, they're private roads. And again, I'll defer to the professionals, two separate professionals. They've come up with that conceptual design.
Okay.
Again, that's where it comes from.
Okay. So I did speak with Olivia, the trustees, as well. Jean and I had a conversation with her to talk about how this, in what we see as a potential path for you. Right. This is what we've been discussing for the last 10 months, is what is your path to at least a CPC application.
Right.
If there are other means by which you wish to convey the land outside of CPC, those are, you know, discussions you have with the town manager or others. And it does appear the trustees are certainly interested because it does abut their land.
Mm-hmm.
They too have their own process where they will order their own independent appraisal and discuss a price with you at that time.
Okay.
I don't know if they're going to be ready in time for February 3rd.
Okay.
To be perfectly candid, I think they have a process just like we do. So my question becomes is if they are not ready for February 3rd, would you hold out for the following funding cycle to next year?
I wouldn't want to, but yes, it's my druthers to you know, it's short, and that's what, when I talked to the trustees, I said, took me a 6-month lead time to get this appraisal, and he's still maybe not going to have it for me by February 2nd. So I understand that, and I'm open, you know, to that.
Great.
But I'd prefer to get it done. I'm not getting any older. I'm 70 years old. Any younger? Excuse me. See, that's an old. Don't get old. You get that brain who doesn't work. But yes, I'm open to whatever can happen to try to keep this land undeveloped. But to the other point is, I'm not a rich man. Okay. So
who among us?
And it's my retirement, and I'm getting closer and closer. So. All of that being said, yeah, this is what I want to do, and if that gets it done, it's definitely possible.
Right.
Okay? So I guess what I'm getting from you then is if the town or the trustees can't get in line in time for February 2nd, then don't submit it. I guess that's where I'm coming. Could I submit it and then tweak that number as this comes along it's in the queue?
Don't tell us that if the town or the trustees don't put it forward, you're not going to go forward. And if neither of them are prepared to do it, you already told us that.
What?
That if either the town or the trustees are not ready to come forward with an application, you're not going to submit one.
Right. Well, that's what I'm asking. Is that number...
The numbers are relevant because we would be right back in the same situation we were in last spring.
Okay.
Is if there's not a land protection partner, then it's not a project for the CPC.
If they're not involved, then it doesn't happen this year.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
regardless
I'm glad,
of price.
I'm glad that's what this meeting's for. That's great.
Yep.
And I would ask, like, John, I don't know in your experience, has there ever been like a right of a ROFR or a right of first refusal? Sold by the, purchased by the town on a parcel? In other words, here's a parcel. It's sitting there.
It's been done, but only in very limited circumstances. I mean, the only one that I know of, and I'm trying to think if anybody was around, is Sunny Ridge was the top of, the top parcel that we have. That required a right of first refusal, but it was for like 30,000 or 40,000. It wasn't very much money, so, but we had to do that. But other than that, we've never done it.
Yeah. So the right of first refusal is kind of like a property interest that said that could be purchased by somebody. So say like the town or the trustees could say like, okay, we will purchase. Obviously, it's not at purchase price, but you can purchase an interest which says if you have a bona fide buyer for this property at a price that you reach, the other party has the right to match that price. Okay. So in other words, let's just say a hypothetical that an Avalon Bay or someone came and said, we will give you X for the land, the town would have the ability at that point because the market value was actually determined by the market and not by an appraisal, because that's an actual market. Like someone wants to buy it for that price.
Sure.
So I don't know, John is obviously
the only time they come up is that when you have property that's under Chapter 61A, it's protected. You actually automatically get that right of first refusal for a period of months to match the price. But that's the circumstance, and it's very limited. I'm frankly not sure it's applicable here, but, it's fair enough to bring it up.
Yeah. I mean, the property is not in 61A specifically for that reason.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Thanks for the time. And
thank you.
I guess, question?
Just a couple clarifying questions. One, the property, there's actually two parcels.
Yes.
So we're talking this one?
Well three parcels. That one, yep.
And the one up here.
And the one below it. That one, too.
Actually three parcels.
Three parcels, right.
Okay. And the appraisal, the appraisal that you're going to be getting, is that based on a developable or undeveloped land?
It's based on 188 units would be one. It would be based on, they could give you three values. And then the highest and best use, obviously, is the multi-unit residential, but they also give you values for the other two. That's where the number comes from. I don't know what it would be. We'll see. And again, like I said, I've owned this property since the 70s. And if it stays another year to see if something can come of it and it can stay that way, that's good. It's not. Unless tomorrow Avalon Bay comes and throws $10 million on the table, God, and it's, yeah. See ya.
God bless you, sure.
Yeah, thank you.
Go for it.
Okay, but that, I don't, you know, everything's on the table. I'm just trying to have a dialogue.
Don't
okay,
hold your
great. Okay. So, okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. I think that was all of our notice of intent. It does not mean that we will not receive other applications. I think that we still may get some others in time for February for our discussion there. So where was I on our agenda? Okay, old business. We have no old business. New business, the only item we have on new business is we want to bring the committee up to speed. The Ridgewood Cemetery Association approached me, I guess it was the first week of January. They were applying for an additional grant of $15,000 for the second burial ground for the Mass Historic Preservation Grant, I think it was. And they had a January 6th deadline to apply. They asked for a letter of support from this committee, which I provided to them. It's in the packet if anyone wishes to review it. Ideally, I would have brought it to the committee first to do that, but given their deadline and we had just approved the funding, I felt comfortable to do that, but I want to make sure the committee is aware of that, and that is in the packet to review. So if anyone has any questions on that, by all means, but it was pretty vanilla. So, and with that, next order of business is approving the minutes from November 10th. Okay, so all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Abstain. Aye. Abstain. Oh, sorry. I will go to a roll call. Sorry. Bill?
Abstain.
Ron?
Aye.
Tim?
Aye.
Rick? Aye.
Yes.
And I am yes. Thank you. And our, can I get a final motion of the night? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. We are adjourned. Thank you, folks. Aye.